panel. I feel like my head is about to explode with thoughts and ideas, and my heart is filled with joy. I just find that the work that they're doing in Holyoke is vital, absolutely vital. In particular, it brings us to our topic today, which is about wage and peace. And as Rudd said, one of my jobs was teaching at Greenfield Community College, but just to give you a little bit of a backdrop about how I got there, I have been a social worker in my life. It's where I first ran across Jane Addams as my heroine. And I worked as a social worker for 20, 25 years, and then was hired by GCC to run their human service program, the two-year equivalent of what social work is. While I was there, 9/11 happened, and kind of serendipitous event occurred where I discovered this field of peace education. So since I was a teacher now, I studied up on this and developed ultimately a full liberal arts degree in peace and social justice initially. And then I added in some environmental courses into that because for me, it was all tied in together. But one of the challenges I always came across in talking about what I did was I tell them I teach peace studies, and they go, well, that's great. Then they go, what is that? So as much as it's difficult to articulate succinctly the work and the thinking of Jane Addams, I think the same applies when we're trying to define peace. So I've made a stab at it, and I want to read you something that I wrote that to me tries to embody all the parts. I think it encompasses a lot of the things that we've already seen today. I think in particular, the restorative justice program in Holyoke. So this is what I wrote. Peace is more than the absence of war. Structural violence in the form of oppressions, economic, gender and social inequality, human rights violations, poverty, lack of resources, and so forth, are as harmful to us as direct violence is. The shared values of social justice, participatory decision-making, nonviolence, respect for diversity, and ecological wisdom are primary elements for a sustainable future. For the cited inequalities of lack of access to resources become the soil for violent conflict. Security and safety needs concern us all and must be reflected in the social systems we create and the personal and group actions that we take. Committing violence on each other and the natural world simply degrades us as living beings and causes trauma and diminished capacity in nature and ourselves. We are witnessing such degradation right now. To gain peace and security, we must begin with right relationships. This term is embodied in the Earth Charter that defines peace as the wholeness created by right relationships with oneself, other persons, other cultures, other life, earth, and the larger whole of which we are all a part. Our security is dependent on establishing a right relationship with the earth and the ecosystems we belong to. Our life depends on this relationship, and our work is to shift our thinking that we have control over the natural world and create a relationship based on living in harmony with the natural world. This, to me, constitutes a broader definition of peace. Thank you. Honored to be here with these fierce women who are waging peace. And directly to my left is Pat Hines. She is Professor Emerita of Environmental Health from Boston University. She is currently the director of Trap Rock Center for Peace and Justice up in Greenfield. It's how we first met, actually, when I was teaching up at GCC. I joined the Trap Rock Board. But Pat does extraordinary things. Her activism, I think, is in the form of her writing. She has written 6 books and has had numerous national and regional awards on the topic of environmental justice. And recently, she's been involved in 2 projects. One is called the 10,000 Trees, where she did fundraising to be able to purchase trees to plant in Vietnam in areas that have been degraded and deforested by Agent Orange during the Vietnam War. And she's also recently met with Syrian women, war refugees in Lebanon, and with the non-governmental organizations working with them. And her work specifically targets trafficking in women and child marriage. And next we have Vicki Elson, who is my newest friend right now, I just met her. Vicki works for the Nuclear Ban US. It's the Treaty Compliance Campaign. And the mission at Nuclear Ban US is to implement the 2017 United States Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons here in the USA, whether or not our federal government is ready to sign it. She is a former doula and childbirth educator, and she has shifted her attention to an even more important way to help babies and families to live happy and healthy lives. And last but certainly not least is Marty Nathan. She's a family practitioner who is retiring from Bay State Brightwood Health Center in North Springfield. She is a longtime anti-war and civil rights activist, founded and directs both the Clinikita Fund and the Markham Nathan Fund for Social Justice, is a co-founder and steering committee member of Climate Action Now, and initiated the local climate group 2 Degrees. She is married to Elliot Fratkin and has 3 grown children and 2 grandchildren. So we'll start first with Pat.
Thank you, Abby, and I want to thank all of you for the tremendous response that I felt throughout this panel. We were like a community celebrating each and every of the speakers. Today's constellation of presentations, ranging from the moral basis of democracy, social justice, including immigration, refugees, and the rights of workers, and with this panel, waging peace, abolishing nuclear weapons, and climate justice, all mirror the dimension, legacy, and profound conscience of Jane Addams, a radical social reformer and feminist to her core. A century before the word intersectionality was coined, she lived it, she embodied it, she practiced it tenaciously. Her work with the poor in Hull House and Chicago slums led her to believe there could be no peace without social and economic justice, in brief, no peace without justice. I speak today on one of her most enduring, creative, and effective initiatives, the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, also known as WILF. The League emerged from the coalition of European and American women, including Jane Addams, who met in The Hague, Netherlands, 9 months after the onset of World War I. The world was hypnotized by blood when more than 1,000 women and a small number of men gathered from neutral countries and also countries at war with each other to demand and mediate permanent peace. The British press, which was infected with war fever, ridiculed these women with overweening sexist paternalism as, quote, misguided, chattering, and hysterical. The roots of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom were twofold. The international suffrage movement, which had united women from the warring Allied and Central Powers alike in their common goal of their equality. And second, their shared passion to end the madness of this first industrial-scale war. So let me note some highlights of this 102-year-old, still vibrant organization. 1919, WILF was the first body to protest the harsh terms of the Treaty of Versailles, punitive terms which historians agree sowed the seeds of World War II. WILF also demanded the lifting of a post-war food blockade by Allied powers, mainly Britain, of Germany and Austro-Hungary, another bitterness that was carried by many Germans into World War II. In the early part of the 20th century, Wolf worked in the United States to make lynching a crime. During World War II, the League was one of the few organizations to protest immediately the internment of Japanese Americans and also made efforts to assist released internees. Wilf, and I don't know of any other organization, I'm sure there must have been, but had the wisdom to oppose NATO's creation in 1948, seeing it for what it is, a Euro-US military organization. In 1957, the organization presented 10,000 signatures to the White House protesting nuclear testing, above ground testing, an action that helped to lead to the 1963 Limited Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. Despite red baiting, the US section refused to ban communist members. And there is room still today in the organization for debates between pacifist and non-pacifist members. Member Coretta Scott King spoke out against the Vietnam War at a Wilf press conference 1 week before Martin Luther King was assassinated. Dr. King was also a member, a Wilf member, and he addressed a 50th anniversary Wilf dinner. And then the League's members helped to organize the 1965 Selma to Montgomery March. Wilf has chapters today in Israel and Palestine, chapters which are leaders in the peace efforts there, and the League promotes a two-state solution. The 1990s saw rapid growth of Wilf in Latin America and the development of a Women's Peace and Justice Truce Treaty of the Americas by North and South sections to promote solidarity and action. The League's members were the largest delegation at a 1998 International Solidarity Conference in Cuba, focused on women and globalization, disarmament, and ending the economic embargo against Cuba. Someone mentioned earlier the UN Resolution 1325, oh, it was Louise Knight, I believe, which it was passed in the year 2000 by the UN. It promotes women's equal and full participation as active agents of peace and security, conflict prevention and peace building in decision-making contexts. In other words, women's equal participation at the negotiation table in countries at war. The resolution 1325 became reality, as I mentioned, in the year 2000, for which the Women's International League for Peace and Freedoms actively lobbied at the UN. But the point Louise made, I believe, earlier was that this was the same position that Wilf took in 1919 when it was initially formed. So to explain sort of my personal involvement with Wilf and what I witnessed up firsthand, I joined Wilf about 5 years ago and learned firsthand the tenacity of their work, engaging with them as I did in the effort to get an act called the Congo Conflict Minerals Act passed by the Massachusetts legislature. It did pass in 2017. And as background, a prime cause of the complex international conflict in the Congo is the pursuit of mineral wealth. It is the longest African war, and among its greatest tragedies is the extraordinary sexual mutilation of women by all warring parties. The Congo Conflict Minerals Act, an act which has been passed by the state of California and the state of Maryland, requires the state of Massachusetts to develop procurement policies on Congo conflict minerals and human rights issues. The goal is to eliminate state procurement of any products with Congo minerals in the supply chain. We think cell phones, we think computers. It took 6 years of nonstop work led by the partners Congo Action Now and the Wilf Boston chapter, building support one legislator at a time, testifying before committees, hundreds of meetings with legislators, organizing phones, emailing, and letter writing efforts. I joined Wilf once I was, as director of the Traptalk Center for Peace and Justice, I was contacted by them to sign letters of support, et cetera. And so I was so taken because I was aware of the sexual mutilation of women and of this longest African war. And so on behalf of the Trap Rock Center for Peace and Justice, I wrote letters to legislatures. I testified before hearings in Boston. I met with Congo Action Now and Wolf in Boston for strategy sessions, and I attended the signing ceremony. But that's where I saw up front the incredible tenacity and commitment of these women. And this is just one section. I mean, they are active in California in stopping fracking. They're everywhere. There is an issue that we had on the agenda today. So here's their 2015 Radical Manifesto in a nutshell. And this is probably the last time they wrote a manifesto. It would be the same today. Disarmament, including nuclear weapons. So they've worked, and you will hear about this issue at the UN to win this disarmament ban. Climate change and climate injustice. This is their manifesto. Achieving democracy, moving beyond capitalism. It's not clear where, but moving beyond it. And I love this one, moving beyond patriarchy. I mean, so you see the combination, nuclear weapons, climate change, climate injustice, democracy, beyond capitalism, beyond patriarchy. So Jane Addams was a woman for all seasons. She was grounded, as we heard, and as we would know, given all she did, in moral values. She had a strong self, but I think this is what saved her and made her work so long-lived and so communal. She had a strong self, but not an ego that eclipsed others. She had and cultivated empathy, another quality necessary for any of the work that we've heard today. She was strategic and pragmatic, aligned with others to build movements of consequence. She was the second woman and the first American to win the Nobel Peace Prize in 1931. So I'm going to end with a quote from a friend and a colleague of hers, Emily Green Balch. She won the Nobel Peace Prize, I learned, in 1946, the third woman to do so. I'll just add about her. I only learned this. I hadn't heard of her, really, in preparing this. She was a professor of social economics at Wellesley, and she was extremely active in peace issues, in Wilf and other issues, and a colleague, perhaps she was even at Hull House. She was fired from Wellesley because she was teaching peace instead of social economics. But I do consider peace an issue of social economics. If you think of the trade-offs between defense budgets and everything else you could do with it. So this is what she wrote of Jane Addams. She was so utterly real and firsthand, full of compassion without weakness or sentimentality. Loving merriment, that's an older word, isn't it? Loving merriment while carrying the world's woes in her heart. A great statesman, a great writer, and one of the world's rarest spirits. So here is to Jane Addams.
Thank you, Pat. I just want to comment on having been a social worker, but also a peace worker for a long time. What you just described about Jane Addams is how she embodies both. She has all those wonderful social work skills of empathy, love of humanity, and wanting to create a better world, just as peace workers do. So, thank you. So next we have Vicki.
Hi. Do you love merriment? I do. So what I'd like to do a magic trick for you. I'm going to talk about nuclear weapons, and when I'm done, you're going to feel happier than when I started. Seriously. Because we have incredible news on this front. This summer, July 7th, 717, July 7th, 2017, an amazing thing happened in New York at the UN. My partner Tim Wallace has been working, he's there in a green sweater. Hi, Tim. He's been working with ICAN, the International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, and he took me down to witness the negotiations for the Treaty on the Abolition of Nuclear Weapons. And we were there when it was agreed, 122-1 at the UN. Now, the people who were there to witness this included all the wonderful civil society people in a room full of ambassadors. The room also included some of the Hibakusha, the people who survived Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And they're very elderly now, and they've waited their whole lives. They've worked on this forever to make this happen. So that was a really life-changing moment for me, and now I'm hooked. We have an incredible opportunity right now. We have, of course, a lot of scary things going on right now with a lot of saber rattling around between the US and North Korea, between India and Pakistan. There are 9 nuclear armed countries. And I actually am kind of looking at that as a wake up. It's actually in one kind of weird way, it's kind of a good thing because it's getting people thinking about the reality. Like, we still have a whole lot of nuclear weapons. We have as much danger as we've ever had on this planet from nuclear weapons. And so that's the bad news. The good news is the treaty. Here's what the treaty does. Check this out. The treaty makes it illegal to develop, test, produce, manufacture, acquire, possess, stockpile, transfer, receive, use, or even, it's my favorite part, threaten to use nuclear weapons. So this whole theory of deterrence where we threaten each other with nuclear weapons to keep each other from nuking each other, it never made any sense at all. It's always been completely absurd, and now it's also illegal. So anybody who helps countries to do these things, you know, if you allow these things to happen on your territory, you allow these things to be moved through your country, whatever, that's illegal too. So it's all illegal now. It's a huge change. Now the other really exciting thing that happened this year, by the way, the thing was signed in September 20th, just a couple months ago. At the UN, it was open for signatures, and we have so far 53 countries have signed it, 3 have ratified it. Don't panic, it's normal for it to take a long time for all the countries to sign it. So we're getting there. There's incredible momentum, and ICAN's working very hard to follow up and make sure everybody signs this treaty. Of course, the 9 nuclear nations haven't signed it yet, and in fact boycotted the negotiations. Some people found it quite amusing that the activists were inside and the US government was outside protesting. That was kind of a fun turn of events. But it's all going to change. Eventually, everybody's going to sign this treaty. We are going to get rid of nuclear weapons. So again, the other good news is that ICAN, the International Campaign for the Abolition of Nuclear Weapons, which is just a handful of young people working really hard, they won the Nobel Peace Prize in October. And that is a huge signal to the world from the saner powers that be that this is an important thing, this is an important moment. We have an unprecedented opportunity now to get rid of nuclear weapons from the face of the earth once and for all. Didn't I tell you you'd be happier? So here in the US, you know, Tim and I are like, well, what can we do living here in the United States? And it turns out that we are in a really important position to help the whole world sign on to this treaty. So what we're doing is we've started a thing called nuclearban.us. It's the campaign for treaty compliance. So what that means is that individuals, organizations, faith communities, schools, groups of any sort, also cities, towns, states, can all sign on to the treaty. We don't have to wait for the federal government to do it. The Paris Climate Accord, you know, got thrown out of the federal government, but people are still signing onto it all over the place. So we don't have to wait for the federal government to do the right thing. In fact, that would just take forever. So we're just gonna do it ourselves. So you can all, right now, take out your smartphone if you want to, go home and open up your internet, and you can yourself take the first step to becoming treaty compliant. And then you can, you know, the website will guide you through the other steps, which involve figuring out, do you need to change your bank? Do you need to change your job? Do you need to change your investments? And do you need to communicate to those institutions why you are changing and put pressure on them to themselves become treaty compliant? So you can do all that. And you can spread the word to your friends and your neighbors and your families and your other faith communities, other schools, other organizations of any sort, your book club, you know, everybody can become treaty compliant. It's going to get really powerful when cities and states start doing it. It's just going to build amazing momentum. And pretty soon, the federal government will just have to follow. A lot of people wonder, well, if we get rid of all of our nuclear weapons, we, the United States, won't that put us in a vulnerable position? And the fact is that all we have to do is pledge. That's the first step of the six steps of becoming treaty compliant, which, by the way, mirror the treaty as it was written. We're just doing it kind of in miniature. So the first step is to make a proclamation of intent to comply with the treaty. And when the United States does that, other countries are going to look at that and know that we're serious and get together and figure this thing out. And we will find ways to agree in a time-bound, verifiable way to dismantle all the nuclear weapons. Don't you love that phrase, dismantle all the nuclear weapons? I love that phrase. So what we need to do is we need to educate ourselves. We need to understand all the myths and all the propaganda that we've been fed all these years about deterrence and unilateralism and all that sort of thing. We need to really start wrapping our minds around the fact that with this treaty, nuclear weapons abolition is happening. It's not pie in the sky anymore. It's the nukes are going. So we have to shift our mindset, our strategies, our paradigms, and fit into this new reality and just get to work. So we're also looking at the federal level, you know, the top down. It's not our highest priority because that's so frustrating, but we are helping to draft legislation that Barbara Lee in California and other legislators may be introducing at the federal level as well. So doing all these steps will put pressure on industry and Wall Street to become themselves treaty compliant. It will help the US prepare for what we believe is the inevitable conversion of nuclear weapons jobs and industries. And hey, while we're converting them, let's convert them to jobs and industries that address climate change. It's kind of the same stuff, right? Just scoot it over. Let's solve two of the world's biggest problems at the same time. Why not? We will be building an unstoppable movement to make the USA sign, ratify, implement, and enforce the treaty. And my favorite part, we are expressing solidarity with the rest of the world. The brave countries that have flown in the face of the US and the other nuclear countries and have already signed the treaty, the countries that are thinking about it, they need to see that the US is not some, you know, pro-nuclear weapons monolith. They need to see a powerful citizen movement inside the United States to encourage them to go ahead and sign the treaty as well. So what's happening so far is we already have groups, some right here in the Pioneer Valley, that are supporting one another in signing the treaty and going through the six steps to becoming what we call treaty compliant. We have a lot of enthusiasm from ICAN and from local wonderful people like Randy Keeler and Francis Crowe, Jeff Napolitano. You guys probably know some of these great people. We have people excited about it in Wisconsin, Minnesota, California, New York. It's spreading out, growing very fast. So the next thing that you can do if this excites you, does this excite you? Please tell me, does this excite you? Yeah, if you're excited about getting rid of nuclear weapons once and for all, do it for your cat. I mean, you know, do it for your grandchildren, whatever. You can take one of these yellow flyers, they're in the back of the room, and they have on them our website, which you can just go to and start the process if you want to. We also have a couple of workshops scheduled, one on this side of the river on December 2nd, another one on the other side of the river at UMass on December 5th. We have workshops where people can come together and support each other in becoming treaty compliant and spreading the word. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Vicki. I just want to comment that I don't know about you or you guys, but I've been feeling very hopeless and helpless recently. You know, there's a lot to feel. You know, there's a lot of sense of something more powerful than us that's hard to sort of fight and wage against. But I think what you've just described is one of the many ways we can find to capture our own power within and then the power together. It really has always been up to us to make the change. I think a number of people have said today that if we continue to look to governments to create the change we want, it'll never happen. So it really is up to us. So one more way to do that. Thank you, Vicki. Next, Marty.
Thank you very, very much. This has been an exciting day. I certainly was no expert in Jane Addams, and I'm still not. Wikipedia is my source. What I read when Red asked me filled me with gratitude for her courage, her wisdom, and her accomplishments in bettering the human condition. Jane Addams was a progressive Renaissance woman. Someone has already said that. I thought that was my line. Whose life and work took on all the pressing issues of her time. And that time was one of both great oppression, violence and inequality, and of growing resistance. Does it sound familiar? In which she played a leading role. She was an outspoken pacifist, stalwart supporter of poor and working people, a feminist, an anti-racist, a defender of the rights of immigrants, and an environmentalist in her own time. Who said they couldn't figure out how she was an environmentalist? I agree with Dave. In her own right, working tirelessly for clean water and air in a city where the poor's daily life was constantly threatened by filth and disease. It's an incredible honor to be here with all these amazing people. We are at a physical, social, political, and perhaps economic crisis or tipping point. The name of this conference was Rediscovering Jane Addams in a Time of Crisis, and that's absolutely apropos. The context of our early 21st century human consciousness is looming environmental and nuclear disaster. The first we are experiencing in real time as a snowballing, which is a very odd metaphor, catastrophe with climate change. The second looms over our heads as our leaders blithely threaten annihilation of small countries and back it up by expanding and upgrading our nuclear arsenal. That is what the Trump administration is doing right now. If you are not scared, you are not paying attention. Meanwhile, our country and our world has become more economically polarized than at any time in my lifetime. Workers scramble for a living wage. She fought for the 8-hour day. None of my patients know an 8-hour day. They are working 2 and 3 jobs to pay the rent while billionaires bank tax-free in paradise, awaiting passage of a tax plan that will eliminate much of their debt to all of the rest of us. Gains in healthcare, particularly for women, are being hatcheted. The regulations against polluting our water and our air are being lifted, even as children in Flint bear the burden of permanent neurological damage from lead poisoning from their taps. The commons, which we paid for in our taxes, is being raped. Immigrants, whose crime was to work hard for their families, are arrested, jailed, and deported. White supremacy is being fed and protected by the White House. LGBTQ people are being threatened back into the closet. There is massive starvation and violence in Yemen. I'm sorry. I'm taking a different tactic. In Yemen, due to a war on the people by our oil ally and Jared's BFF, we become increasingly involved in the massacre and destruction that is Syria today, The Republican tax plan will grant a massive subsidy to the rich and their corporations, which, along with a proposed ballooning of the military budget, will be paid for, without doubt, by cuts further into the, in the social safety net, which has already been tattered. Jane Addams' new versions of all of this. First and foremost, she lived and worked among, offered services to, helped educate, and supported organizing by the Immigrant Poor of Chicago. She knew war, she wanted peace, she knew repression, she wanted democracy. I personally am most focused on the mounting catastrophe that is climate change. Carbon dioxide in the atmosphere grew last year at a record pace, reaching 403, someone here said 408, I'm not sure which is true, but both of them are disastrous parts per million, half again what it was in 1750. Our global temperature has risen a degree centigrade. The 10 hottest years ever recorded have all occurred since 1998. The hottest year on record is 2016. It broke the record set in 2015, which itself broke the record in 2014, and 2017 will probably be hotter. That level of warming has already led to the deaths now not of 58 people, but of hundreds of people in Puerto Rico by Hurricane Maria, massive flooding in Houston, and devastating wildfires throughout the West. We are on a fossil fuel road to hell on Earth. With temperatures headed to rise above 2 degrees centigrade, the road is littered with landmines, minefields, melting up glaciers and sea ice, dissolving tundra, forest fires. Each of them can commit us to independent, runaway global warming. Yet, word that Washington, like Nero, was only fiddling while the planet burns. Instead, the Trump administration is doing everything in its power to literally and figuratively feed the fire. It has withdrawn the Clean Power Plan that would have controlled emissions from coal-fired power plants. It plans to open federal lands, the Gulf and the Arctic, to mining and drilling. It has prevented even reporting, let alone regulation, of methane release from gas fracking sites. And it would build the Keystone XL to bring the near endless, filthy tar sands oil to the Gulf for export. At this moment, its representatives are selling fossil fuels and nuclear energy at the Bonn United Nations Climate Conference. The US being the only nation on Earth not in on the accords. The administration's consultants and its audience are the Kochs, ExxonMobil, and Massey Energy, all of them set to squeeze the last little bit of profit out of our poor Earth, no matter what the consequences. What do they care? The victims have only been Haitians, Filipinos, Puerto Ricans, and the mainly African-American poor in the Texas and North Carolina coasts. The perpetrators will survive in their air-conditioned fortresses in the upper latitudes and upper altitudes, away from the heat and the floods and the poor. Pretty dismal. I don't think this would have been any news to Jane Addams, whose life spanned the Gilded Age and the wealth extremes of the 20s. She knew World War II, Jim Crow, and the Great Depression. She fought unbreathable air, sewage, and she gave us a motto: fight it all. All people deserve relief, and protection, food, housing, clean air, and health care. Don't back off. Use and expand democracy. Believe in women. Stop war and build community. Tear down the barriers of class, race, ethnicity, gender, and sexual preference. As I said, we can learn from that message. We are at a crisis point, staring into the abyss of climate change and nuclear holocaust. There is already way too much suffering in this world, and I see no way, unless each of us, like she did, begins to shoulder the moral burden, that we can avoid a terrible future. But others have said, we also face one of the biggest opportunities. In stable times, we are all more likely to tend to our individual business, but in crisis, people pay attention and have a stake in the way forward. Now, in 2017, we have the chance to transform our society at the same time that we must transform our society in order to successfully combat climate catastrophe and nuclear holocaust. As for the climate, we have to throw all our efforts into energy conservation and the building of new green infrastructure, renewable energy in the buildings, grid, and transportation systems that it supports. We need a transformation to sustainable agriculture, reforestation, healthcare for all, and mammoth expansion of the caring and education fields. Those are green endeavors. The resources to make this all-pervasive switch are there in the subsidies for the fossil fuel industry and in capturing their externalized costs, all the things that are not in their price. Estimated to be more than $5 trillion per year. I wrote that wrong. $1 trillion per year. In the military budget, in the bloated prison industry, and in the massive wealth squirreled away by the very rich. There are more than enough jobs, clean jobs, with a living wage to be found in a new economy. Despite our federal government firmly entrenched as the enemy, I believe that we can and that we must make that transformation. But we cannot do it unless, number one, we are comprehensive in our vision and willing to multitask politically. We must incorporate justice into environmentalism, combine the peace and climate change campaigns, and ensure that everyone has a voice, particularly the young and people of color, who are more progressive and environmentally focused than are us old white folks. We might call ourselves environmentalists, but we need to show up, like John has said, show up against police brutality and the detention of migrants. Public health means both cleaning the air and ensuring full nurse staffing in hospitals. The women's movement needs to be there on the picket line for labor. Second, we cannot do this unless we do not give up on the federal government. But we must stand up loudly and clearly against all the transgressions that they are making against us. Each of us then must throw ourselves into electoral politics to replace those who are driving us full tilt down the road to hell. Work for voting rights and registration and overturning Citizens United. But to quote Stephen Stills, number three, if you're not with the one you love, love the one you're with. Translated, if you can't move through the federal government at this moment, use every government forum available. There's legislation pending on Beacon Hill that would put us well on our way to 100% renewable energy, single-payer healthcare, and criminal justice reform like what Aaron talked about. Make sure our legislators act on it in this moment. We cannot do it unless we use everybody's skills and platforms, internet, housing councils, churches, art, music, friendly conversation. Us gray-hairs need to learn to tweet, and the new generation must learn from our long experience fighting war and racism. And unless we are willing, ready to fill the streets and sometimes the jails, demonstrate and consider, be ready for civil disobedience. People put their bodies on the line in Sandusfield and recently in Boston. The stakes are that high. Sometimes we must risk for our children's future. It may not be what you choose, but be ready to support others when they do. And sixth, always, always create, cultivate, and enjoy community as you act. We are fighting hate and greed. Our counterforce is love, generosity, understanding, and empathy. It sustains us when we get tired and when we stumble, as we always will. Note that this is certainly the most important time in our lifetimes and probably the most important moment in human history. Rely on the wisdom of our forebears, Jane Addams, Martin Luther King, Ella Baker, Cesar Chavez, and the longing of our children for a livable future. Let us build a new movement. Thank you.
Thank you, Marty. I hope you have become inspired. You certainly gave us a very full list of things that we can do and need to do at this point in time. So this is a clarion call for all of us. Thank you so much. We have about 5 minutes or so with questions from the audience. Somebody doing the mic?
I just want to say thank you for so boldly pointing out all the challenges, because a lot of people really don't want to hear it. I listen to the radio a lot. I just are blown away about how many times they talked about Roy Moore in the past 24 hours when there would be so many other issues, environmental issues, the laws being rolled back, local issues that need to be addressed, and et cetera. So, I know a lot of people don't want to hear the gloom and doom, but actually we really need to work on this conversation about that. And so to add to that, right now, this past week in Boston was Greenbuild, and Greenbuild is the green building conference for the region. And, probably over 20,000 environmental professionals were in that. And I'm a designer by training, and I got involved in watershed stewardship thanks to Rudd. And I was really happy to read it. I wasn't able to participate in that conference, but I noticed that for probably maybe the first time that the Charles River Watershed Association was a speaker at that conference, and also there was a women's conference as well, and the International Dark Sky Association had their conference in line with that. So I think that there's a lot happening, But this particular group here can really do a lot by going back to their churches, their schools, their neighborhood associations, existing organizations, and just asking them to change the physical, to the energy sources, the make sure that their buildings are LEED certified. Those efforts make huge differences, but it sort of starts from understanding being positive means being fierce. So that wasn't really a question, but you guys can respond to that.
No response. I would just add, and maybe provoke, that much of my life has been in Africa, and the environmental crises are extraordinary. So when I said this morning we can anticipate more movement of people, I mean it, and those are people with less resources. So I think conflict is probably predictable, large and small. And I'm not just referring to Africa. But then from my perspective, for the last 15 or 20 years, I don't see how we sustain a capitalist worldwide model. It is not sustainable. And then there's a curious thing that seems to be happening. We use democracy to define capitalism, and we use capitalism increasingly to define democracy. Now, there's something out of whack there. If you want to chew on that, fine, but yeah. Thank you, by the way.
So Jane Addams said just that. She was a democratic socialist, and if you go back to her writings, she was very clear by the very values of collaboration, cooperation, respect for everyone, non-exploitative relationships. She certainly spoke to that, but too many people in our country were not ready for that. I want to check something with Louise Knight, wherever she is there. Wasn't it in her writing A Moral Equivalence for War that she called for a competing passion to the drive to power and militarism? And she began to elaborate on it, enunciate it, but it's, to me, central. It gets back to Pat saying right relations. I don't think simply by, and I think it's very important, I don't want to preclude going and seeking very policy changes and campaigning for this or that. I don't think we're going to get the breadth of grassroots support for that, whether it's in Alabama and Moore country and the people who vote for him regardless of what he does, or anywhere else, unless there's a real transformation simultaneously in the way people think and feel about issues in which war is very characteristic. So when I think about developing a kind of trained imagination, get back to that concept that spoke about in the morning, to educated empathy, to these things, we need a transformation of our educational system. And we've gone down the road of privatization, homeschooling, parochial schooling, everything but the vision of a democratic education in the way that certainly, I think, Jane Addams had in mind, and that she has written about. So one of my requests, along with all the wonderful suggestions you gave, Marty, and I concur with all your grim descriptions, they're absolutely true, is that we get involved with our public education system, that people enter into school training, teaching, nursery school, elementary school, to encourage at high schools, we don't have the young people there, so that not a superficial civics education takes place, which we don't have, by the way. Most people in this country don't know how our government is functional when they graduate high school. But that there's a training and an alternative, if you will, moral passion, which is what Jane Addams called for, that would generate the kinds of feelings and thoughts, respect for science and respect for human life, that would enable people who live in areas where they're in their silo social media, if in their schools they had teachers who would introduce them to another way of thinking and feeling that might help produce some of the policy changes that are absolutely crucial. So I encourage you all to get involved in public education issues because I think that's fundamental to everything.
I want to just respond very briefly to what you said. Thank you about the public education. In my peace studies, I happened to meet a gentleman named Captain Paul Chappelle, who was a captain in the Army. He's a combat veteran, traumatized both in his childhood as well as his experiences in war, in the Afghanistan and Iraq wars. He is turning his experience around into trying to teach about peace, and his idea is creating peace literacy so that we're all literate in what peace means. And some of the very things you said, some of the things we've all talked about today, I think incorporate all of that. We are hoping to bring him back to this area next year in the fall, so stay tuned for that, but thank you for bringing up that very important point.
Could I just follow up on that? We will be bringing Paul Chappelle to speak in the fall. We are looking for, we will bring him to that Holyoke High School group. I talked with him, we are very eager for that. But also, we are looking for sponsors for him to speak. I spoke with, is it David at UMass, about UMass sponsoring Holyoke Community College, Greenfield Community College. He's an educator who really teaches the principles of peace literacy from his own personal life as well. It rescued him, so we'll keep in touch about that. But if anyone is interested, either a church congregation or a school, to co-sponsor with us, this is the Track Rock Center for Peace and Justice, we'd be very happy to. I have one last question actually for Vicki, if we have time, and it has to do with the nuclear ban treaty. As I recall, it also includes requiring the countries who signed the treaty, ratify the treaty, to work to persuade other non-signatories to sign on. I found that a very unique aspect of a treaty where you not only do it yourself, but you then work to persuade others. Is that true at the smaller scale? Is it something that's hopeful? No, I meant the countries themselves.
Oh, yes.
Let's say Switzerland signed on. Are they going to talk to Germany to try to persuade them? It's a very unique condition in a treaty, I think.
Yeah, that is part of the language of the treaty, I believe, and it's certainly part of our campaign that when you're done, you spread it around to other people, too. That's the only way that this is going to happen.